Are you ready to record WandaVision episode 8?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Well, we're doing it.
I'm Dennis Hopeless.
I'm Kyle Strom.
And this is Dennis and Kyle Record WandaVision episode 8. So before we get started, I want to remind everybody that our final episode of Dennis and Kyle Record WandaVision is going to be a live stream. We're doing it this Saturday, March 6th at 7 p.m.
This was a big exposition dump, wasn't it?
And I said last week I was super excited for this episode because it was going to answer all these questions, and I had so many of them. And so I got up first thing Friday morning. I considered staying up Thursday night until 4 in the morning. And as I was watching it, I was super disappointed. The questions that I wanted answered weren't being answered. It wasn't propelling the superhero plot and the big Marvel Universe question marks forward. It was a frustrating watch. It wasn't until the stinger over the credits that I got one of my big, like, oh shit, moments. Oddly, I spent much of the week frustrated with this episode. But last night, we rewatched it. I watched it again with my girlfriend, and not obsessively waiting for them to say Dr. Doom or Reed Richards or Mephisto. And it's a fantastic episode from a character standpoint, which is usually my jam. Like, that's what I like to write. That's what I like to watch. There's a bunch of really great scenes in it. So it's weird, at least in my brain, they've created an expectation of a bunch of, like, surprising MCU and 616 moments that when they stop and actually delve into what the show's about, which is Wanda's grief, you're like, oh, come on now.
We've talked about it before. Expectation is what molds anybody's opinion of anything they watch, especially so with these big, these huge properties. Well, my expectation was that Agatha Harkness was going to continue to have some of that, like, goofiness. She turned into a dark villain, sort of, which was a little disappointing for me. I thought it was very clever. A lot of little clues now make a lot of sense, and I thought they did a really good job on that. Let's run through it real quick. The show opens in 1693 in Salem, where Agatha is, we think she's going to be burned at the stake, but really she's being punished by her coven for seeking out some forbidden knowledge. And they all try to kill her, but she ends up killing them and taking her mother's brooch. Then we flash forward to where the last episode left off, in the basement. And Agatha wants to know why Wanda is able to do all the things she's able to do. So that's her motivation. It's not about the kids, unless there's more coming. So she takes her down to memory lane. Doctor Strange did this in Thor, I think. He took one of Thor's hairs and created like a doorway. And that's the same thing she does. Opens a door. They go back to the past. They go to Sokovia, where Wanda's whole family is sitting down watching old TV shows from a box of DVDs. The episode of the Dick Van Dyke Show they're watching is, it looks like a walnut, or it could be a walnut. Walnut aliens start taking over everybody. And at the end, they wake up and it was all just a terrible dream. All right, back into the timeline. A bomb goes off and kills her parents. The kids are stuck under the bed for like 2 days waiting for a Stark bomb to explode, which never does.
And that beat was described in detail in Age of Ultron, because I've now rewatched Age of Ultron as well. Looking at Stark's name, waiting for a bomb to kill them for 2 days, is the thing that motivated them to go join Hydra and to sign up to be experimented on, to make them powerful, to try to stop the Avengers. Wanda and Pietro's character arc in Age of Ultron is all about them coming to terms with the fact that they had made bad mistakes because of that event scarring them. She becomes Avenger, and Avenger at the end, Hawkeye tells her, if you want to be a scared little girl hiding in this church, you can do that. We'll come get you afterward. But if you step out this door, you're an Avenger. And then she steps out and is a badass and takes out a bunch of Ultron clones and is one of the most heroic people at the end of that movie. A lot of that is baked into Age of Ultron.
That's cool. I like that a lot.
But they add to that beat. After that, Agatha tells her why the bomb didn't go off.
Which I don't remember. Why doesn't the bomb go off?
Agatha pulls Wanda back out of it, like yanks her from the backside of the bed. She says that she's a baby witch who cast a probability spell, which is the reason that the bomb didn't go off, but that power would have died on the vine. Because at the beginning of the show, she's frustrated that Wanda's so powerful without having practiced at all, because she doesn't know what the runes are that are protecting the room, and she clearly has never learned any magic, but she can do crazy level, high level magic over a widespread area without even trying, and Agatha's trying to figure out why.
And then they flash to the Hydra experiments. They're in the Hydra compound. And this raised questions for me. They bring in Wanda to confront an Infinity Stone, and she touches it. That's when Agatha says the thing about it would have died on the vine. Like, the Infinity Stone amplified some magic within her that otherwise would have gone away. And my question is, what? Do all people have that? Is it like the Force? Is it another mutant thing? Because why does she have that and her brother has super speed?
My assumption there was she was saying that she had some latent magical abilities, were brought out by the stressful moment of the bomb, and would have just gone away, but then the power of the stone powered them up. Agatha seems kind of uninterested in the different events. It doesn't answer the bigger question of how is this person, like, godlike powerful in this town with her witchcraft.
Was she brought in by Hydra just because they were taking anybody and they noticed that she had that? And if so, then how does Pietro have super speed? Like, he didn't confront an Infinity Stone, as far as we know.
My understanding is they volunteered, and all the other volunteers were killed by the stone. I would guess the show is telling us that Wanda's magic protected the both of them, because it protected them with the bomb, and that it still had that protection. But it's also possible that there's some latent mutant stuff happening that we'll learn later.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, mutant stuff.
Because if you think about Magneto's origin story, it was those traumatic World War II moments that caused his mutant powers to come out.
Yeah, and the difference being, we all understand the backdrop of the Holocaust. When she does look in the stone, she sees a figure descending that looks a lot like her with her Scarlet Witch mask. Could be her, probably is. After she collapses from touching the stone, she is watching the Brady Bunch, right?
In her cell, she's watching the Kitty Carryall episode of the Brady Bunch when Bobby tells Kitty that there's nothing inside that doll but rags and sand.
After that, they go to the Avengers compound after Age of Ultron. Pietro has died.
This is my favorite scene in the episode. This scene, because I think it explains a lot about their relationship. I've mentioned many times on the show, there were great performances setting up the relationship of Wanda and Vision throughout the course of the MCU movies, why they are with each other and how much we're supposed to care. But going back and rewatching all of that stuff now, those scenes have a lot of resonance. And this scene shows, I think, the moment Wanda fell in love with Vision. She was watching Malcolm in the Middle, stone-faced, clearly not enjoying it, but watching it out of habit, I guess, in the Avengers compound. And Vision comes in and tries to comfort her, saying he'd be happy to talk to her about Pietro's death if she wants to. And she's like, why would I want to talk about it? How's that going to help me? Nothing could help me except for seeing him again. And Vision explains that he's never had anyone, so he doesn't really know what it is to lose. But what is grief if not love persevering? Which is a fantastic line, and also exactly what she needed to hear. And then they start laughing at Malcolm in the Middle together. And that's clearly the moment where, like, her feelings for him blossomed or whatever. That scene was awesome, especially the second time around where I wasn't frustrated we weren't hearing about Reed Richards.
Yeah, that's a great line. It's a wonderful piece of dialogue. Agatha is moved to tears and wipes a little tear away. I don't think she's necessarily a huge villain. Her motives are unclear, but not nefarious. So they go to the S.H.I.E.L.D. compound. This is right after Wanda has blipped back after the Infinity War, and she wants to see Vision. She goes in there. There's some weird, is it Hayward? Is that his name?
Director Fuckface. Yeah, it's Hayward.
Yeah, so there's some weird stuff with Hayward that I enjoyed, especially because without making a big deal out of it, they showed us that he's been lying the whole time. I don't know how to interpret some of the things he said. He said he had a moral or a legal and ethical obligation to dismantle Vision, but he also mentioned Vision's will previously. So on the one hand, he could be legally and ethically obligated because this is what Vision wanted. On the other hand, he's full of shit, so who knows?
I wondered the same thing watching the first time. Watching it the second time, it's super obvious that he's full of shit. He set that sequence up in order to try to motivate her to bring him back to life because they've been trying. If you tie that on into the stinger, they've clearly been trying to put Vision back together. And the main clue, other than the fact that he has a glass room next to his office where you can see them fucking with Vision to upset her. In his timeline, they've had Vision's body for 5 years. So the coincidence of them dismantling it today, the moment she walks in, Also, we get the impression she's been waiting at that desk for a minute. So I think that was all staged to try to trick her into using her powers. And he's just using narcissistic manipulation to make her think she wants to do something that he wants her to do.
I thought that that was sort of a ridiculous looking set piece. But then I saw a screen grab of like the comic and it looks almost exactly like that. So I was like, oh, that's kind of cool. But then she leaves angrily. She takes this deed the Vision had purchased for them, I assume.
Yeah.
And there's a heart drawn on it that says, we'll grow old here. She drives through Westview. We see a lot of characters. We see a guy taping a piano lessons sign to the wall who later is the piano player. We see the woman who is sitting alone with her wedding ring clearly visible, who later is the wife of Vision's boss in the first episode. We see the same sorry delivery man who's been in it like four or five times delivering a pizza. Then she drives up, she collapses in the middle of the lot and explodes in a burst of sadness and stylized Tetris piece magic. And she builds the whole town. This takes us right to the first episode.
After that, we jump back to her in the here and now in that set, but you can see all of the lights. It's like she's actually on the soundstage where they're filming that sitcom, and the Dick Van Dyke Show set is what we're looking at, but it's in color, and Agatha's sitting in where the studio audience would be clapping, and then disappears, and then Wanda hears her children screaming and runs outside. And Agatha, in her full badass witch accoutrement, is floating in the air with magical leashes around the twins' throats. And she tells Wanda she was supposed to be a myth, a magic user that can create at will. She's the Scarlet Witch, and that she's been using it to make breakfast for dinner.
And she mentions chaos magic for the first time, I think.
Which, that beat is interesting, because if you know the comics, she's saying nothing you don't already know. You know, we know her name's the Scarlet Witch. We know she has chaos magic. We know all of that. And then the best part of the whole episode comes after that, after the credits. There's a stinger.
They go into the lab, the sword lab, and activate a being which appears to be Vision's body, but it loses all its color and becomes the white android Vision. And it wakes up because they used some energy from the hex that they got with one of the probes they sent in.
That's the drone that when she walked out, she dragged out with her. The one that they tried to kill her with.
I was pretty happy to see White Vision. I almost mentioned White Vision earlier in an episode because that's the way that I knew Vision the first time. And when I was in like fifth grade, somebody had a West Coast Avengers comic and that's what he looked like. So my understanding is White Vision is like an emotionless robot who's not loving in any way.
Well, the storyline this is based on is where White Vision came from. He dies and he gets his mind wiped when he comes back, and he comes back as just an android after their relationship.
If this turns out to be true, what I'm about to say, it will be my favorite thing about WandaVision. And there's been a lot of talk about a big guest star showing up and a quote from Paul Bettany. And so I went and looked up the exact quote, and he said, there's a huge reveal with an actor that I've always wanted to work with. And I have some explosive scenes with him. And if he's talking about White Vision.
Himself?
And himself. I will love it.
That would be awesome.
We've said Doctor Strange. We've said Reed Richards. All kinds of stuff. And somebody came up with the theory that Dick Van Dyke will show up as the big bad. Which I read an interview. They said they hired Dick Van Dyke to just be a...
A consultant,
yeah. He didn't have any idea what Avengers was, and they told him it was the biggest movie ever, and he's like, oh, well, that's very interesting. But there's a whole interview, so it's very possible.
Oh, if Dick Van Dyke is Mephisto, that would be the most amazing thing.
That would be amazing.
For one thing, Mephisto can look like whatever he wants to, so Mephisto could look like old man Dick Van Dyke, which would be pretty big mind fuck. That's the show that she hid in the wall. It's the show she thinks cares the most about of all the shows.
And they've done this before in Guardians of the Galaxy 2, exact same setup with Kurt Russell. When you were talking about Wanda becoming the Scarlet Witch, which is clearly a thing that people know about, who's super powerful, I think it's interesting that it's just the Phoenix story, but because Phoenix has been done like three times now, this has kind of taken its place and is very exciting.
Yeah, well, I mean, it was always baked in. Wanda and Pietro are interesting characters because they started out as just side bad guys in Magneto's gang in the old original X-Men stories. I wrote X-Men Season 1, which is a modern retelling of the Stan and Jack X-Men, the first year on X-Men. So I've read those, and they kind of just stand in the background. Like, they didn't do much. And then when they revived them and rehabilitated them for Avengers, they became main good guy characters in that. And then, you know, in the years since then, they've vacillated back and forth, and they've done all sorts of crazy stuff with them. Wanda, much like Jean Grey, was not much of a character at the beginning when she was created, and because of that is like a blank canvas that people have used to do cool stuff with. The idea in the comic, I think, has always been her mutant ability allows her to tap into magic without having learned it. Wanda's emotions make her magic real badass. Like, if she gets upset, she's freaky, scary, powerful. And that happens way back at the end of Age of Ultron when Pietro dies and falls down. Wanda feels it and knows it, and she takes out like 3 dozen Ultron robot things in like a blast of emotional power.
Yeah, and in Endgame, of course, when she almost kills Thanos, the only one to almost kill Thanos.
In Age of Ultron, they don't want to say she has magic. Weird is as close as they get to using the word magic in Avengers. But now, clearly, as the supernatural elements of the Marvel Universe are being beefed up, they're talking about her as a witch.
I think that that's something Marvel has done really well. Because when Thor was about to come out, my big concern was, how could this possibly fit what we've already had? In that one, they did the same thing. They just hand-waved over it, and they're like, it's science you don't understand yet. Now we've had Doctor Strange, and we've had so much stuff that they're just like, yeah, it's magic, whatever. And we accept it.
I don't know. The best thing about this episode is Wanda's grief has been suppressed this entire time. Like, she says when they're watching Malcolm in the Middle that she knows the dad's not going to be gravely injured because it's not that kind of show. So she's put herself in that kind of show where nothing actually bad can happen. So, you know, she's in the denial stage or whatever of grief. And in this episode, Agatha forces her to deal with her grief. She forces her to look at it and see it. And at one point she tells her, you've already lived it once, like it can't hurt you. So there's a way to look at this where Agatha is pretending to be a bad guy because that's what Wanda understands, but she's acting as a therapist. Like, she's making her look at and deal with this stuff and actually, like, feel her grief. The first time I watched it, I thought, this could have been 12 minutes of this show. We could cut all these scenes down, have it happen faster, and then the second half of the episode could have been, you know, from White Vision on, setting it up for, like, a really explosive season finale. But I think we need to see that grief, because we've been waiting all these hours. We know she's having it, but we don't see it. And when you get to the moment where the grief explodes out of her and builds a town, like, the fact that it was an accident, it's not just a dream for everyone else to live in. It's a dream she was living in. Like, she didn't know what was happening. She suppresses all of those emotions in that moment so that she can be happy. It's great. Like, it's really good. And I think it's necessary. It does feel like they've left a lot on the table to resolve in a season finale.
Oh, they really have. But they're not going to resolve it all. They're going to give us a little and push it on. And then 2 weeks later, we'll be dealing with something else and the Falcon show. A big thing that hasn't been resolved is Pietro and Monica. They'll probably open on that in the next episode. And the rabbit, this rabbit that keeps showing up. I want to know what it is. It might just be her familiar, but she was feeding it things and it was talking to her in the last episode. Like, it whispered in her ear. I don't remember what context that was.
I mean, it might have just been Catherine Hahn chewing scenery, but it does eat that locust thing, or that cicada that she pulls off the wall and turns into a bird. When she turns it back into a cicada, the rabbit eats it. And I don't think rabbits eat bugs. So or that birds. Was weird. Yeah.
Surely she'll explode into her Scarlet Witch costume, right?
Yeah, I would imagine. Wanda and Pietro in Age of Ultron at the beginning, they're angry teenagers who had a terrible trauma in their childhood, and they just want to punish the person that they see responsible. And so she's dressed in that, like, in like emo punk. Like, she's got a little bit of red on, but she's got like black half sleeves and her eye makeup's all messed up.
In Civil War, she was in like a long red coat that kind of looked like a cape, but not really.
And then in this, we've seen her in like a costume version of it.
For the viewers who aren't really aware of who the Scarlet Witch even is, it was very smart of them to seed her Halloween costume when she shows up, they'll have a point of reference for what the hell they're looking at.
Yeah, I definitely think we're going to get to the badass witchy version of that outfit at the end. Because they could put her in like a full-on witch outfit, like something that would look at home at a Renaissance festival or something.
We've got one more.
One more.
The next one could feasibly just be a fight. There could be no Mephisto. There could be nobody above Agatha at this point except a teaser.
Because everybody's big complaint of the Netflix Marvel shows is that they had 6 hours of story and 10 hours to play with, and so they padded it out. And this show does not feel like that. It feels like they stayed pretty true to the story they're telling. Like, this is very much just about Wanda and Vision and Wanda's grief and all that. So if they just resolve that storyline and then give us some teases for stuff that comes after, I think it'll be satisfying.
Yeah, I think so too.
It seems like this is heading toward a really tragic ending where she's going to have to sacrifice probably both Visions. Real life grief, you don't get the option of having the person back. Someone dies, they're gone. Is that where we're going? Are we going to an acceptance where she accepts that he's gone? Or is this going to leave us with some sort of Vision that doesn't remember her, a la every Robot Friend movie?
Because the MCU doesn't like to return to the status quo. They like to shake things up. I think of Hulk the most. Like, the Hulk is different, and every time we see him, he's got a different thing going on. I think White Vision survives because I don't think they're going to want to lose the character. But I think he's completely emotionless and she's in a bad place. With the hint, maybe this can be implanted in here at some point and he'll be back. But I don't think they're going to give us that happy ending.
The most interesting ending. Now, last week I had a most interesting nonsense that didn't play out at all. But the most interesting ending would be for one of them to end as the big bad going forward, which makes sense for both of them. He warns them whenever they go to fight Ultron. Vision tells them, like, I'm not what Ultron is. I'm not what you are. I'm not what you were trying to create. So maybe you can't trust anybody, but, like, you can't do this without me. And then he hands Thor his hammer, and that's how you know that he's worthy. He tells you in that moment that he's potentially a really, really scary bad guy. Like, it's a super android made out of vibranium skin and powered by an infinity stone. But also, a grief-stricken Wanda who has to lose Vision again, who starts to lose it a little bit, is a House of M bad guy.
Mm-hmm.
And so,
well, she'll probably have to kill Vision again.
Exactly. So if she has to kill Vision again, or if she has to sacrifice her version of Vision, who's in love with her, and the other one stays around, is the final moment of the show the House of M moment? Because if you think about it, her powers keep spreading out this fantasy, and in House of M she does that for the whole world. So does she fully power up, and then in a moment of grief at the end we get the resolution, and then that happens, the whole world changes, and the last moment of the show is whatever she changed in the universe, and then all the other shows could take place in that universe. Like, you could get mutants in the last 10 seconds of this, and then when Falcon and Winter Soldier starts up, it's just a world with mutants.
And what you described would make me excited to see Falcon and the Winter Soldier, right? Because then I'd be excited to see what has changed.
They're not afraid of that stuff, because all this shit still takes place in a world where half of the people have lived 5 more years than the other half.
So for the final episode of WandaVision, episode 9, we're going to do our last episode of this as a live stream on Facebook on Saturday the 6th at 7 p.m. Central Time.
So Kyle and I are going to watch the show, and we will time it based on how long the show is to start the live stream right as the show is over. So we will have just watched it. So if you want to have the same experience we do, watch the show right before 7 o'clock on March 6th. So we'll be doing everything we normally do on here, but minus all of my editing to make us sound smart. And we'll answer your questions. We'll dig into everything. We'll talk about what we got right, what we got wrong, and what we're excited going forward. So we'd love to have you with us.
Perfect. Dennis, where can people find you on the internet?
My Twitter is HopelessDent. My Instagram is DennisHopelessComics. I'm Missouri Swagger on TikTok. And I'm 2 places on YouTube. Chances are you're one of those places right now watching this. Where can you be found, Kyle?
I am on Instagram, KyleStrom_, on Twitter at KStrom, and on Facebook with my name. And I'm on Patreon too, which is Patreon/KyleStrom. Well, thank you, everybody. We will see you during the next one.
Toodles, doodles.